Hello everyone and welcome to another episode of The Surge. My name is Saad Al-Zaid and today's topic sort of reminds me of William Eindhoven's first EKG machine. When EKGs were first made and designed, we tried our best to understand how to use them, and it was mainly an electrophysiological sort of art. And at that point it was an art. Remember, this was analog. And the main clinical application was to check people's heart rates when they were in sepsis and when they had infection, to try and figure out the quote-unquote burden of infection. Since then, we've moved a long way, and as I'm sure everybody knows, EKGs have become part and parcel of your emergency room workup for almost every cardiac condition that you can think of. They've also become almost routine in certain populations perioperatively. And I can see today's topic becoming very similar in terms of the management of blood products and predicting the propensity for bleeding in patients. So today I'd like to talk about vasoelastic hemostatic assays or thromboelastography and rotational thromboelastometry. The technology has only been around for 60 years, and to give you a brief idea, Eindhoven's EKG machine did not start to become a multi-lead machine for about 80 years. We didn't actually come up with standardized leads for 80 years. And TEG and ROTEM's only 60 years old, so we've still got a long ways to go before we understand exactly how this stuff works. But still, having used it recently in our center here in Kuwait, and this is a picture of our thromboelastography machine. They're very nice, small machines. This is a fairly old version, the parallel port version. I think that the newer ones now come with USB-based interfaces and work significantly faster than this one, but it's still a pretty good machine and it runs fairly reliably. It also didn't cost us that much, to be completely honest with you. We currently have it in our pathology and hematology lab, but it's easily moved into different settings, and we sort of tend to use it where we need to use it most of the time, and it guides our resuscitations once we've hit above 4 units of packed RBCs in hemodynamically unstable patients. Just like EKGs and just like every part of the EKG, from the P wave to the QRS complex and the T wave, equate with different parts of the cardiac cycle and reflect the electrophysiology of these parts of the cardiac cycle. And different waveforms, beat-to-beat variabilities, tend to tell us whether or not somebody has a underlying pathology. Thromboelastography does the same thing for your in vivo coagulation cascade. Going from the platelets to tissue factor activation of the platelets, up to and including activation of all the direct and indirect pathways, or the initiation phase and amplification phase, all the way down to the conversion of prothrombin to thrombin and subsequent clot formation, with fibrinogen being converted to fibrin. And the way that it does that is by showing you a curve of viscosity over time. And one of the best illustrations of what each part of the curve means, very similar to the EKG I showed you earlier, can be found on Rebel EM. And it's by Raze et al. Under Rebel Reviews. And I encourage you all to go through Rebel Reviews because it saved my life more than one time. And it's pretty good, actually. In fact, this picture is printed and put on many of the walls in places where I work. Because initially I didn't know how to read text. And B, because it provides a just-in-time education and just-in-time teaching for people within your ED as you're doing your thromboelastography. So the first thing that you read off of a TEG is the R time. And that's the time from when you have the initial insult, quote-unquote, or reflects the time from when you have the initial insult to when your body realizes it and triggers clot formation. Globally, the longer that is, the more FFPs you have to give. This is just a global sort of idea of things, and it may not be the correct approach in a couple of years' time, but for now, prolonged R times are met with FFPs, unless there is a result of some sort of anticoagulation, in which case they'll be met by a targeted reversal agent, either based on guidelines or based on consensus and your in-house hospital protocol. For example, with Coumadin, you might want to give Octoplex, Beriplex, or Prothrombin complex, etc., etc. Your K time is the time from when you start forming a clot to the time when you're at 2 millimeters amplitude. Your maximal amplitude is your maximal clot thickness, and that reflects the quality of the clot overall. It's sort of the bigger picture with the platelets, the DDAVP, the cryoprecipitate, and the FFP all coming together. And the angle between the initialization of the clot, i.e. the end of the R time, and the maximum amplitude is called the alpha angle. And that reflects the need for cryo, essentially. It's a fibrinogen-based parameter, just like the K time is. And in my mind, K and alpha angle fit in together. And they're my trigger to give cryoprecipitate. They're also my trigger to give additional FFPs. Because in certain cases, and I'm not sure why, some of the issues, let's say, or some of the gradient of the alpha angle seem to be better reversed with FFPs and seem to be more resistant to just giving cryo. It may be the quality of the cryo that we have here, but something tells me that there's more to it than that, and we'll be hearing more about in the literature. The lysis at 30, or the LY30 and the LY60, are basically how much of your clot is lost at 30 minutes and how much of it is lost at 60 minutes. Bear in mind that with newer machines, you have rapid thromboelastography, and that involves activating factors through, that involves the addition of activating factors such as kaolin and others that we'll get to later. And your LY30 may be different for different machines, and it sort of has to be recalibrated every now and then. For me, a prolonged LY30 or a less percentage of clot at LY30 is a better way of putting it, is a trigger for me to use transexemic acid. However, in our center, we very rarely see this because we tend to give transexemic acid early. We're crash two believers. And the cost benefit of giving it is just, it makes it very hard for us not to give, let's put it that way, as an institution. So we tend to give transexemic acid early when we recognize the need for massive blood transfusion, especially because we serve a very small patient population in terms of catchment area. The patient transport from one end of Kuwait to the other is about 2 to 3 hours at most, if you don't factor in traffic. So we're more prone and more likely to get traumas early on that fit the crash 2 criteria, and so therefore we have an excuse to give it, and we haven't had any major issues with it to this point. So when you look at a normal TEG is a normal R time, a normal alpha angle, a normal K, and a normal maximal amplitude. When you have anticoagulation on board, or when you have a global or specific factor deficiency, no matter what it is, the first thing I tend to see in my patient population is a prolonged R, then a prolonged alpha K, and a decreased alpha angle that's at a slight slant. The maximal amplitude tends to sort of be a little bit less, but it's a very nuanced difference. And when you spit out the numbers on the machine, they tend to be variable from patient to patient, at least in our center with our machine, which is fairly old. So I tend to rely on the curve itself more so than anything else. But again, the maximal amplitude is sort of the last thing to get hit when I have a factor deficiency, when I need to give FFPs. It's more for prolonged R and a decreased K that triggers me with a more sloped out angle, or more sigmoid angle, more aptly. Whenever I see thrombocytopenics or patients with platelet blockers, they tend to have a more prolonged K and a decreased maximal amplitude. And the clot tends to take a long, nice long sort of smooth curve to it. I see this a lot more with Plavix than I do with aspirin, to be completely honest with you. I think that it may have to do with Plavix's stopping power. I also tend to require more platelets whenever I see this with Plavix than I do with aspirin to correct the curve. TPR fibrinolysis is something I've never seen. I've seen DSC pictures that look like that, and they worry me a lot, and it's usually in patients who've required a significant amount of blood to maintain their vitals. They tend to have a decreased maximal amplitude and an ongoing decrease in maximal amplitude from the measurement of the maximal amplitude down. It sort of looks like a needle almost, but it may not be as typical as the picture is here. But still, you'll know it when you see it because it just dips almost instantaneously on that curve. In hypercoagulable states, there's a shortened R time, there's a shortened K time, and the alpha angle is almost always a vertical line. I see this randomly from time to time in certain congenital hypercoagulable states, and in patients who are in the ICU who tend to have a more of a propensity for it. Again, I'm not sure how to react to it. In our institution, we tend to give clexane fairly liberally, or enoxaparin, to patients that are quote-unquote at risk based on clinical findings. And we never really treat this with intent, but it may be something that we'll have to start treating once we see it more often, once it's studied a little bit better. In DIC, we get the same hypercoagulable curve, but it tapers down at the end in a very similar manner to the way that the curve does with the fibrinolysis diagram. This is in the first stage of DIC, when we have our typically what's described as a hypercoagulable state. You have an increased maximal amplitude, a shorter R and K time, and an increased alpha angle, but then you have constant fibrinolysis towards the end of the curve. In terms of our stage 2 DIC, you have a smaller maximal amplitude that takes longer to get there with a longer K and a decreased alpha angle. It's not something that's very subtle, and it's something that has varying degrees, to be completely honest with you, but it corrects very well with cryo and with transoxemic acid. And just like with Betamax and VHS, there are two different types of viscosity tests, and TEG is the one that we have in our institution, but I've also been in contact with ROTEM and I've used it before. For me, the key difference is that number one, they use different terms for different things. And number two, ROTEM tends to provide with more data and is easier for our technicians to learn. In places where they've had ROTEM, the technicians just seem to be a little bit more confident at making it work. But again, for me, it didn't really factor in significantly in terms of my resuscitation paradigm, and I think that the utility of ROTEM lies in the subtle differences between the two. It's kind of like the differences between Betamax and VHS. In my mind, TEG is like VHS. It's more studied, it's more prevalent, it's more distributed, they have better distribution chains. But Betamax has the slightly higher resolution, slightly higher color gamut, more portable, and is the mainstay of a consortium. Unfortunately, Betamax sort of failed epically and VHS took over. I can't see the same thing happening between TEG and ROTEM, though. I think that they'll both have equal roles to play, but one will become more of a hematologist's tool. The other one might become more of a resuscitationist tool with time, especially as the types of measurements that they make become more and more nuanced, and more data comes out on where they're more useful. And believe me, they both have different limitations, but for us in our institution, TEG was available, and TEG was considered relatively cheap for multiple reasons that I'll get into a little bit later. So the R time, or the time from initiation of clot to 2 millimeters amplitude, is called the clot time in ROTEM. The K time, or the time from 2 to 20 millimeters maximal amplitude, is called the clot formation time. The alpha angle is the same in both. The maximal angle isn't even measured in TEG and is measured in ROTEM as CRF. The maximum clot firmness is the maximal amplitude in TEG and the maximum clot firmness in ROTEM. The time to max strength is only measured in ROTEM, and it's measured as maximal clot formation time. And the routine amplitude measurement times are at A30 and A60. And that's what the machine spits out at you in terms of the numbers on the side of the curve. In ROTEM, it's more A5, 10, 15, 20, etc., etc. I have not seen any good literature on the utility of more amplitude numbers. I'm pretty sure that eventually we will learn something about it, and it'll probably become an index score that we'll use. But for the time being, I don't have enough to react to. I don't know what to do with something that's deviated at A10 versus A30 versus A60. Similarly with lysis time, I know that at LY30, if I have a severe amount of significant amount of depletion, then I'm going to be giving some transoxemic acid, but I don't understand the nuance of LY30 versus 60 versus 30, 45, and 60. And in our trial, maybe at least, those things get put on the back burner. In terms of technical factors, TEG, you have to manually pipette onto the assay cartridge. In ROTEM, you just feed it the blood sample and it does the business for you. In TEG, the cup itself is moving, whereas the needle is fixed. In ROTEM, the cup is fixed and the needle is moving. The reason why these things are significant is because of how delicate the machine might be. ROTEM's relatively bulky machine, and it's relatively fragile compared to TEG. This is sort of not literature supported in any way, but what I've heard from people who've used both devices, both on the field and in austere circumstances and better circumstances. The angle of rotation, or the frequency of the readings off of the machine, is 45 for 5 seconds in TEG and 75 and 6 seconds for ROTEM. So ROTEM slightly higher resolution. Again, we're talking about Betamax versus VHS literally. The detection of viscosity in TEG relies on pin transduction, i.e. how much the pin feels the force. And in ROTEM, it's about how hard it is to turn the pin, or impedance of rotation. The key difference here is that impedance of rotation might be influenced by, say, things that are moving around, or by how fragile the needle is in and of itself as it's being moved around. The temperature for TEG and its reagents has a wider gamut than ROTEM, and although they mentioned 24 to 40 degrees and a maximum of 40 degrees for both, the supplies for TEG don't have to be refrigerated for us here in Kuwait, and that's a huge advantage in terms of cost of shipping. We occupy an import economy, and so therefore we have to ship everything in. So it's a huge, huge, huge deal for us to have something that we don't have to put in a fridge when we ship it. And the reagents and cartridges for TEG don't have to be shipped in a fridge. You can just send them over through whatever method you want. Whereas in ROTEM, they're strictly stop at 40 degrees. It's not validated after that point, at least not by the company. Temperature control in TEG is through a heated cup, which allows the device to be smaller and more portable. We move ours around routinely, depending on where we need it and how we need it. If we have a major case going on in the OR that we know might require its services, then we move it to the OR from RED. ROTEM is a little bit more bulky, and that's saying something. It's a bit of a job moving it around, and it's not that easy to use in terms of that nature. It's a big disadvantage for us in our center, at least. And it comes with a heating metal block, and that's part of the reason why it's so hard to move. In terms of the actual costs, the TEG machine and the reagents are cheaper, but bear in mind that each cartridge only has two assays to run, whereas ROTEMs are a little bit more expensive, but you can run four assays at a time. So maybe in an institution such as an obstetrics one, where you would routinely have postpartum hemorrhage that would require this type of technology, ROTEM might be the way to go because it's fixed. It doesn't have to be portable. And it's point of care at the same time. And most of your obstetric work is done in a relatively close setting that's close by. But for us working in the ED and the OR and the ICU on given days, TEG seems to be the way to go. I like the fact that it's portable. I like the fact that it uses a PC connected to it with Windows as its brain. That means that I can adjust the software and I can update it accordingly, and it's easy to update. And I can use a laptop instead of a full-blown PC, which makes it easier to use in our emergency room and have it connected through a network bridge to our HIS or EMR. Although we haven't done that in Kuwait yet, it's something that is in the pipeline and I've certainly experienced before. The other thing I like about the TEG software is that I can have multiple clients to one quote-unquote server, where the TEG machine is connected to one PC and then I have three or four other PCs that can access the same network. And I can look it up from those PCs fairly remotely from anywhere within our intranet. ROTEM relies on Linux with on-screen instructions. It's a little bit harder to use, a little bit more finicky, and you can't build a software bridge. It has to be manually entered afterwards by the technician. Again, not the easiest to do, is prone to error, and it leads to a delay in transmittal, at least in my experience, and I may be wrong. TEG has the finickiness within its software to be able to detect heparin if it's in the sample. ROTEM, not so much. You sort of have to read the fine print on your own. There are some reported cases of vibration resistance or movement of the moving parts for TEG. I suspect it's because it's more portable. That's why it's being reported more. Looking at both needles, the ROTEM needle is far more fragile. In terms of looking at the body of the research globally, TEG seems to be more studied in vivo, whereas ROTEM is more studied ex vivo and theoretically, and is a favorite of hematologists, whereas TEG has become our mainstay for traumatologists and surgeons, cardiac surgeons, cardiac anesthetists, and obstetricians. Again, you can clearly see that they both have a key role to play, and they both have advantages and disadvantages, and that's why I think that they'll be alive for a little bit longer than most people assume. Also bear in mind that both TEG and ROTEM are still evolving and have gone through various iterations. You have things like NTEM, which relies on contact activation to speed up the process, HEPTEM, which tries to figure out if there's any heparin in it, FIBTEM, which uses multiple inhibitors to try and block out the platelet part of the clot to get a more accurate analysis of other factors. Similarly, TEG has Kaolin-based TEG, which is a faster way of getting the numbers. As opposed to waiting for 60 minutes or 30 minutes, you can get it in seconds or minutes. Rapid TEG, which is even faster. HTEG, functional fibrinogen assays, where it's basically a digital subtraction angiogram of two different curves. The software sort of figures it out for you, but you need to run the sample twice. And other different modifications, and a lot. Some of these modifications are software based. Others are in the actual machine itself. Our machine doesn't do most of this stuff, but we do have rapid TEG, and we can do Kaolin, as well as finagled way of doing platelet mapping. In terms of the interchangeability, i.e. if you start off with TEG, can you switch to ROTEM and vice versa during the same resuscitation? Extremely rare, yes, but it may happen. You may have both machines and one of them might break halfway through resuscitation, or while getting a patient off pump, or while you're moving a patient to the OR. Let's say you have a contract for a TEG machine in the ED, but you have a contract for a ROTEM machine in the OR. Unfortunately, the numbers aren't interchangeable, and that's why I rely on curves. Curves will allow me to interpret the pathology without looking at the numbers themselves. And that was the original approach that many cardiologists had to EKGs. They eyeballed them initially and then subsequently developed that more nuanced understanding. And I don't know, that might be the way to go, that may not be. But for me, it seems to be working out pretty well. And it's only been a short period of time, relatively speaking. But I'm a big fan of TEG right now. And it's changed the way I resuscitate patients. It's sort of like I have the playbook for the coagulopathy, and I know what I'm going up against. In the real world, the fact of the matter is, yes, the machines cost a lot. Yes, you're talking about $40,000 a year in terms of US dollars, including taxes. But that's still cheaper than providing the blood products that we require for massive blood transfusions in your typical trauma center annually. You'll probably use less blood products. You'll probably have a shorter ICU stay. You will probably have less related blood complications. There haven't been any meta-analyses that have proven that, but there have been various reports in the literature and meta-analyses that you use less blood products, so it stands to sense that you'll get less transfusion-related reactions. You'll have more blood products available for your other patients, and whether or not that translates to more life saved depends on what type of center you're working in, to be completely honest. I wouldn't know. And I don't think that there's a good study to support that in terms of both the ethics of it and how to work out the numbers. But it stands to reason that if you're using less products on one person, you can use them for another person instead. And this is just the tip of the iceberg. I'd like to think that both TEG and ROTEM have a role to play in how our blood bank responds to us when we give them a call, in terms of how we respond to direct oral anticoagulants and how we try and reverse them. And yes, I'm talking about things like DOACs and NOACs, and how we define things like DIC. Especially looking at DIC, the two or three cases that we've had recently, without divulging any details for patient confidentiality, it smells like DIC. It's clinically DIC. The fibrinogen levels are low, but the curve doesn't really translate to it, and the patients kind of do well. The curve looks funny. Scenario number two, sorry. The curve looks funny. The fibrinogen levels are normal. The guy's still bleeding. It doesn't look right. You give him the cryo, you give him a little bit of platelets, and all of a sudden things look good. You're like, well, maybe I should listen to the curve more and listen to the fibrinogen level less. And sort of that for me is something that is really on the horizon. And I think that over the next 2 or 3 years, we're going to see more and more definitive literature on what DIC is, what fibrinolysis is, what the stages of DIC are, and it will all be TEG targeted and TEG defined, or thromboelastography / ROTEM defined. I also think that in the various different surgical pathologies that have quote unquote a higher risk of DVT, TEG will become useful. In those borderline cases where the risk benefit of thromboprophylaxis, therapeutic anticoagulation, etc., is put to question, the decider might have to be thromboelastography and whether or not your patient's hypercoagulable prior to starting prophylactic or therapeutic anticoagulation. And your dosage and method of anticoagulation may also be dictated by your TEG curve and ROTEM curve pre and post. And that's something that I think is extremely important, because theoretically, if we can get that right amount of thromboprophylaxis for every patient, we'll have no complications at all. We won't have any DVTs, and we won't have any post-op bleeds either, which is kind of like the holy grail of perioperative medicine. That and pain control. Funnily enough, one of the better studies that I've read on how hypercoagulability can be observed in vivo using thromboelastography came from a canine model that was published recently, on how a brachiocephalic obstruction of the airway, not of the vessel, can lead to a hyperthrombotic state and hypercoagulable state. Very interesting study. I encourage you all to read it if you have access to it. And remember, all of this is just the start. This is what a first-generation EKG looked like. There's no way I can interpret that. And I think that most of us would have a hard time pinning a diagnosis on what we're seeing on the screen right now. And this is where we are today, in almost every hospital around the world. That took about 120 years-ish. So give it some time. You know, it's very easy for us to say that INR and TEG, or point-of-care INR versus TEG, in terms of resuscitation, in terms of interpretation, just isn't justifiable in terms of cost-benefit, and in terms of impact on mortality as an endpoint, but that was 2015. And now that we are in 2017, we know that use less blood products, you have less of an ICU burden, although not statistically significant, and your patients overall may do better at the end of the day. If they're survivors, they will do better at the end of the day. At least that's my take-home message from these papers and others that I've seen in the literature. So it's kind of like the iPhone in my eyes. We're waiting for that one phone or that one test to rule them all. That'll tell us how much our patients are bleeding, how much we need to give, and whether or not we need to give them thromboprophylaxis. All things blood. And eventually, we'll be able to correlate every single part of this curve or every single part of this cascade and figure out exactly where we are. And I think that the cool part will be when we can give individual factors and we can make quote-unquote custom-made synthetic quote-unquote resuscitation products. But I can't see that happening before the day I retire, so I wouldn't hold my breath. This is Saud Al-Zayed. Thank you for listening. And I guess I'm signing off.